Today's class is about specimens of toxicology and similarly specimens of wet specimens. That means the specimens we have preserved in our museum. And we are not discussing all specimens, mainly because most important specimens which are in your exam point of view. We are directly going to some of the toxicology, most important toxicology specimens, which we have kept in our own museum. This is actually fruit of Datura plant, and it is there, and it can be kept for your exam also. And it's spherical fruit with sharp spines. It's also known as thorn apple. And fruit, one single fruit will contain somewhere around 500 seeds, and it is called as classified as under Delirium group of poison. And this is dry seeds of Datura. They are yellowish brown in color, kidney shape, odorless but bitter in taste. So active principles are hyoscine, atropine, and hyoscine. And it is all these things are having anticholinergic action, and fatal dose is around 10 seeds, and fatal period is 24 hours. And for this, differential diagnosis is seeds of chili. It will be looking like seeds of chili, a little bit bigger, and pure reniform, kidney shape. So you can, if you compare them, you can appreciate very easily also. It is considered as a differential diagnosis. And next one is Rathi seeds, that is Abdus precatorius. And many different colors may this thing is available, means different species are there. And it's egg-shaped seeds and bright scarlet red color with large black spots. You can see in the upper thing. And all these photographs we have taken from our mortuary. So all this you can expect in your practical examination, because practically in treatment, these poisons are very rarely encountered in normal practice. But even though rare, we are getting cases. So you have to, at least for your exam point of view, even for your entrance exam point of view, you have to know all these things or about all these poisons. Then white, simple white color seeds are also possible. White with black spots are also possible. Then abrin and abralin. These are the toxic principles present in these seeds, which are tox albumin, and it will mimic viper snake venom in its action. It inhibits protein synthesis. And 90 to 120 milligram is a fatal dose, and 3 to 5 days are the fatal period after consumption of this much of amount of these seeds. And it is very previously, nowadays all many methods are there, so we won't be using, but it's a very commonly used cattle poison in shape of poisoned needles. They are known as suis, and it can be asked in your viva also. And these are around 15 centimeter long needles, which will be dried, means paste of this abdus seeds will be pasted over it, and it will be dried, and it can be used as poisoning of cattle. And previously used for abortifacient also, but in not in modern medicine, in other untrained people. And it can be used as it was used as an arrow poison also. Then the next one is Ricinus communis or pasture plant. So these are also there in our museum. And the left side, in left side you can see the it's got fruits, and in right side in that bottle you can see dry seeds of castor. And fruit is roughly 1.2 to 2.5 centimeter in length size, and it's a three lobe, very soft and spiny fruit. And so it won't be it is there in our campus. Even the previous two things were also present, are also present in our own campus at many places. And it will be three lobes. That is very typical of this. And that will, fruits will be seen as bunch, not like the tura. It's a single thing and it's big. These are smaller one, and they will be found as bunches of fruits. And all parts of the plant is poisonous, but seeds are most poisonous because the resin is more concentrated there in the seeds. And resin is the toxic principle of this species. And you can remember that because it can be asked as a sub-question for your supporters. This will be kept. Question can be asked like what is the toxic principle, what are the medical legal importance, that are the questions we are expecting in toxicology specimens commonly. What is a fatal dose, what is a differential diagnosis? So means if you can, if there is something to mimic this thing, that can also be asked. So this also, this inhibits RNA polymerases and block protein synthesis. And but after removing the resin portion in factories, we can produce castor oil that is used as purgative. And fatal dose is 5 to 10 seeds or 6 milligram of resin. It's very potential drug for killing people. And if you search resin's history, you will be getting some famous, notorious assassinations by using resin. Then fatal period, 2 days to several days. It's a range, and accidental poisoning is common and in children also. And the proton seeds are actually means differential diagnosis of these seeds. And differential diagnosis means sometimes child may be brought to emergency and they will show us this. Child has consumed 10 number of this seed. So if you can diagnose, means then only we can go for the treatment part. So to understand that thing, to rule out the differential diagnosis, you should be knowing it. Then next one is actually marking nut. It's also known as species name is Semicarpus anacardium, and they are black heart-shaped nuts, means dried nuts with a rough projection at the base. Pericarp contains erythrin juice and active principle is semicarpol and bilvanol. Fatal dose is 5 to 10 gram and fatal period is 12 to 24 hours. Differential diagnosis is crude opium. It will be looking like crude opium. And a medical legal importance, man, it can be used for making artificial brewery in malingering. So that means bruises or contusions are actually injuries due to blunt force. So in a blunt force, you will be getting a bluish area over here, means the area where it was hit. And it can be false allegations. If you want to fabricate a wound, making contusion over the body is not that much easy. It is very painful. So sometimes people used to use this marking nut and mark it as, and it will look like contusion. And how to differentiate artificial bruise, means fabricated bruise, from normal contusions, you can read about it. Even it can be asked as a tumor question in your exam, theory exam also. So, or in Viva also. So read about it, how to differentiate artificial bruise from contusions or bruise, normal bruise. Then criminal abortion may also, this can be used in abortion sticks. You can read more about abortion sticks also. At least in obscene gynecology, it may be useful. Then crude opium is dried juice of opium poppy plant, Papaver somniferum, and that is extracted from the unripe capsule of Papaver somniferum. That is incised longitudinally to collect white juice and it allowed to evaporate and obtain opium. It'll be almost blackish in color. You can see this is also in our department, so you can expect this also as a spotter. So round irregular blackish mass when it's dried, and fatal dose is 2 gram, fatal period is 6 to 12 hours, and diagnostic of opium poisoning, a triad of coma, pinpoint people and respiratory depression. Opium poisoning also can be asked as a short note. And we have two more specimens related to papaver. One is dry and dry poppy capsule. Photos are coming next. These are the first one is poppy capsule and the second one is cuscus, poppy seeds. So dry and dry poppy capsule contain traces of opium and used for sedative and narcotic action, having narcotic action. Opium is a CNS depressant, depresses all centers except oculomotor, vomiting center and sweating center, and it's actually a peripherally acting analgesic. Poppy seeds are white, harmless, nutritive. Oil from seeds used for cooking purpose, that means cuscus. This is also present in our museum, so you can expect this also for your sport purpose. Then calotropis, madar or acdo. Active principles are usherin, calotropin, calactin and calotoxin and calotropin. Leaves and stems when incised yield thick milky juice, so you have to identify it. Half of the mark in spotters will come from identification commonly. And second question commonly, fatal dose or is medical legal importance. Medical legal importance, it can be used as an abortificant in abortion sticks and artificial brewing, or it can be used as an arrow poisoning also. Arrow means tip of the arrow can be dipped in the concentrated solution and dried it. So it can cause, after getting injury, it can cause the signs of toxicity. Then oleander leaves. Oleander is also a toxic plant. White oleander, Nerium odorum, and the yellow oleander is Cerebra thebaisia. Leaves are narrow, lenceolate shape. It's a cardiac poison. All parts of the plant are poisonous, and fatal dose is 5 to 10 leaves and fatal period is 20 to 36 hours. So identification is important. After seeing it, you have to identify the species. Then bhang leaves, dried form, it is kept. Even wet specimen of cannabis is also there in department. So plant name is Cannabis sativa or Cannabis indica. Principal constituent is active. Principal constituent is tetrahydrocannabinol. It's a CNS stimulant, and bhang is prepared from bhang is many different preparations are there from this plant. Bhang is from prepared from the leaves of the plant. These are things you can expect in multiple choice question for pre-PG exams. Kanja is basically dried flowering tops of the female plant. Charas or hashish is resin from extracted from the plant, and a fatal dose are given of THC is 30 milligram per kilogram. Then strychnus or Nux vomica seeds. These are also there in department, so you should have to identify it in spotters. Seeds are flat, it will be almost like a 25 paise or 50 paise coin, and the seeds are flat, circular disc, slightly convex on one side, and opposite side it will be concave. And the active principles are strychnine and brucine. They are alkaloids, plant alkaloids, and strychnine is 20 times more poisonous and toxic effect is more. Mechanism of action is typical of this plant, so you should be aware of that thing. It completely blocks other previous things are cardiac poisons or delirium poisons, different group method. But this is entirely different category of poison because it completely blocks ventral horn motor neuron postganglionic receptors. And it prevents effects of glycine. That means that will go for muscular paralysis in case of strychnus poisoning. You won't be feeling any CNS will be normal. The patient will be well aware, but he will go for muscular paralysis. Even means there is a typical posture also. It is known as opisthotonus. That also can be asked for your multiple choice question. Fatal dose is 1 crushed seed is more than sufficient to kill a person, and fatal period is 1 to 2 hours. It the symptoms resembles tetanus infection because CNS will be perfect. Means the unfortunate thing is about this poison is actually patient will be well aware till his death. Then it's a common cattle poison and used for killing stray dogs. Is extract of the strychnus are commonly used to killing of stray dogs, and it's an arrow poison. It can be used as an arrow poison. Then copper sulfate is also known as blue vitriol, occurs in large blue crystals. This is powdered crystals of copper sulfate. Then it's a powerful inhibitor of enzymes, and the fatal dose is 30 gram. Fatal period is 1 to 3 days. Medical legal importance is suicidal. Previously, suicidal purpose for suicidal purpose, farmers used to have this, but nowadays we are having many multiple options, better options for committing suicide at least. So nowadays, copper sulfate poisoning became very rare in practical purpose, practical use. And because children, in case of children also, poisoning is possible, commonly accidental, because they will be attracted towards this dark color, they may have it, and that may end up in acute poisoning. Another heavy metal poison we commonly keep for exam is actually lead tetroxide. It's also known as vermiloron syndrome. Scarlet red in color, metallic poison, means heavy metal poison group. We are only giving two samples, means many salts are there, but these two at least you should be knowing, because mainly because of typical color you can identify it also. Then metallic lead and its salts are poisonous, and the fatal dose is 20 to 40 grams. Fatal period is 1 to 2 days, and acute poisoning is rare. This is also there. This specimen is also there in our museum. This is cobra. Scientific name is Naja Naja, and it's having a long cylindrical body. Foot on dorsal side of the foot bears a spectacle mark. That is a common identification feature. In case of snakes, the common question asked for your spotter exam is identify the snake and give two reasons. So you have to write at least one or two reasons minimum. How did you identify this species? So you can read your books, and you can get better options also, because spectacle mark is a signature of this species, and small head with large scales, round pupil, round tail, or the venom is neurotoxic. You have to read more about venoms of different types of venoms of snakes. Anyway, in case of Elapidae family, or in which the cobra belongs, the venom is neurotoxic, and fatal dose is 12 milligram, and fatal period is 30 minutes to 6 hours or even more, depending upon the site of bite and weight of the patient, etc. Another one we have in our department is a specimen of common crane. It's also known as, scientific name is Bangara ceruleus, and it's steel blue in color and a shining texture, and single or double white bands across the back of the species is a typical mark of identification feature of it, and creamy white belly is another identification mark property. Otherwise, head is covered with large shields, and the scales over the back are large and hexagonal. A line of hexagonal shields are present at the exact midline of back. That's a typical of this species. And it also belongs to same family, Elapidae family, and neurotoxic venom. Venom is neurotoxic, just like our cobra. And symptoms differs from that of cobra in being milder. Commonly, symptoms will be milder. And fatal dose is lesser than that of cobra. It's only 6 milligram, and fatal period is 30 minutes, 6 hours. And I think wet specimen, you had one class previously. We won't be keeping all our wet specimen for your exam purpose. So be keeping, these are the common specimens we keep for your exam purpose. The normal kidney, there is no injury in this. And you can expect photos of specimens also. And kidney laceration, we have one specimen in our department. You can see the laceration clearly. Because kidney laceration comes due to kidney get lacerated due to increased intra-abdominal pressure following blunt trauma to abdomen, and its medico-legal importance may it can be present in accidents and in case of blunt trauma to abdomen type of homicide cases, and it is fatal. In many cases it is fatal, and it commonly it can be seen with combination of splenic or liver laceration, and there can be no external findings in case of kidney because our abdominal wall is very much resilient. So bahar se you won't be getting abrasion, even abrasion or contusion outside, but inside you will be getting proper kidney lacerations. And this is consolidation of lung. This is a specimen, so you have to write that. If you get it in exam, you can write consolidated lung, because it's not air filled, it's completely sinking in water. And we may be getting permanent edema also along with pneumonia. So your question will be most probably identify the specimen and write medico-legal importance. So pneumonia, it can be due to aspiration also. And in chronic conditions also, you can get consolidation of lung, but because of secondary infection. Consolidation of lung is basically pneumonia lung. Then we have many fetuses, but commonly for your exam purpose, we'll be keeping two. And this is the first one. Sex can be identified in specimens by this month, 4 to 5 months. So it will be male. You can see the external genitalia. If it is appearing bahar, means if it is clear, you can comment on it. Then lanugohyoid will be present by this time, and head is 1/4 of the length of the body by this. This is all external features or morphological features which is helping you in identifying the age of the fetus. Okay, then umbilicus is situated near pubic symphysis, papillary membrane appears, and meconium will be reaching up to the duodenum part. Meconium means that bile colored things you are getting in GIT in case of fetuses. Then we have one specimen of a term baby, means 9 month term baby fetus, and so scalp hairs are longer and about 2 to 4 centimeter. Lanugohyoid disappear by this time. Nail grows beyond the tip of fingers and toes, and both testes present in scrotum. Meconium found in rectum, that will reach up to rectum, and umbilicus is present midway between pubic symphysis and symphysterum. This is almost take term fetus, features of identification features of a term fetus. And there is a specimen of stab injury in heart. You can see the stab injury, it is marked there. And the stab injury means this is actually a completely perforating wound of the lateral wall of left ventricle. And it can be possible, very rarely it can be possible in accidental manners may also, but commonly we are getting this in homicide cases, means to an extent murder cases. And it is instant, it's almost fatal in almost all cases, provided there is no that much emergency treatment got in front of a big hospital. If someone gets stabbed like this, there is a rare chance of getting survive. Otherwise, this is fatal almost always. And in internal findings, pericardium, left chest cavity will be containing that much blood, and the pericardium will be anyway torn with knives, and the pericardial sac will be blood stained. A film of blood stained fluid will be present, or even some amount are also possible. Then this can be commended as incised wound. Incised wounds are cut wounds, can be, you can sharp weapon wounds, we can basically divide into two. One is stab wounds and incised wound. Incised, you just remember, whenever you are hearing incised wound, you just simply remember surgical incision. That kind of wounds means their length is, as per definition, incised wound, length is more than the depth of the wound. If depth is more than the length of the wound, we use the term stab. And properties of margins are, it will be clean, because you just remember, whenever you are hearing or discussing incised wound, just remember a surgical incision, then you can answer the question. Clean cut margins, and three dimensions, you have to measure length, breadth, and depth of the wound. And it is having sharp edges. This is not a wet specimen, it's a photo of an injury. It can be kept for your spotter exam. And multiple incised wounds at front aspect of wrist, that we commonly get it in suicide cases, because sometimes the person may be person may try to commit suicide by cutting the forearm vessels, but it is very, very rare and it's not that much practical. So they'll be trying it multiple times, and so the psychological status of the patient can be seen at front of the non-dominant hand. Commonly we used to get it on left front of left forearm, and but commonly all these injuries will be are parallel and will be having some tailing at the inner aspect of forearm, be cutting like this. So this end is showing will show some tailing, means it will become shallower, 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 and it will become a linear aberration. That is known as, that is basically the concept of tailing. That will give you the direction of application of the shock force in case of incised wound. These are superficial incised wounds suggestive of hesitation cut or tentative cuts. And many medical legal importance are there, but in your exam, if you are asked about incised wound or stab wound, you just keep this point, at least these points in mind. You'll get an idea about the type of weapon and method used, whether it is a single-edged weapon. If it is a stab wound, we will get an idea about whether it is a single-edged weapon or whether it is a double-edged weapon, or how much sharp the weapon is and in which direction we use the weapon. So direction of and relative position of the victim and weapon, if someone cut either say, and the height of relative height of the person and the victim. So you can deduct many findings, many opinions from the appearance of the wound over the body. Then hesitation cuts commonly indicate suicide manner of death. Defense wound indicates homicidal manner of death. Defense wound commonly we use to get in stab. There is a natural instinct to protect ourselves, so we will be protecting. So we'll be getting multiple choke wounds or incised wounds here. So the as per seeing the position of the wounds, you will get some idea about the manner of death, and appearance will indicate his age also, because 7 days before one person try to commit suicide, and there will be healing stages. So how to aging of wound anyway is important for you. Abrasion, how to age an abrasion by looking the color of the wound, scab color, and falling off of scab. Similarly, you will get, and anyway, means non-fatal wounds, incised wounds will produce a permanent scar. So in many cases of our cases coming to our mortuary for postmortem examination, we are getting multiple linear scars, okay, of previous attempts or failed attempts of suicide. That is giving us will give an idea of previous suicide ideation, some psychiatric illness, something. And we have a good specimen of trachea, and trachea and tongue also you can appreciate, I think two specimens are there. So tongue also you can appreciate in this thing, and black soot particles are present. In close look you will find it out. Soot particles are also present inside the trachea. Tracheal mucosa, adherent to tracheal mucosa, you can get soot particles. That is, next photo is actually we have taken from our mortuary, and these are all cases of burn cases, death due to burns. You will be getting this because there will be many soot particles in the air, and the person will inhale it also. So they will be get deposited in the mucosa and mucus and mucosa of trachea. And it is a confirmatory thing that says this person breath while he was, means when there was a fire in the room, means he breathed it out after death, because it will be useful for us mainly to differentiate postmortem and antemortem burns. Because after committing homicide, after a person killed a person, we can pour some kerosene or petrol over the body and you can burn it also, especially for destruction of evidence. Many murder cases, mein, the accused used to burn the body of their victim. So you won't be getting, if it is strangulation, you won't be getting the proper strangulation mark if the entire area is charred. Then also we will get an idea about the case, because in case of homicide, post-mortem burns, you won't be getting this thing, because suit in trachea, this is the medico-legal importance of the specimen, what I showed you before. Suit in trachea is a confirmatory thing, a confirmatory finding we get it in, commonly we get in homicide anti-mortem burns. Absence of spot particles in anti-mortem burns, commonly we are getting spot particles in anti-mortem burns, but in some cases, especially if the incident occurs in very much open area, windy area, so you may not be getting proper spot in trachea. And if mouth and nostrils are properly closed, tied or something, you may not be getting. And if the person is treated for 1 week or something, by the time due to therapeutic intervention like suction, endotracheal intubation, like, you won't be getting. Otherwise, you'll be getting. This is actually a broken heart, or it is burst heart, or a crush injury to heart. Thoracic cage may be injured due to, in young person, it may not be, rib fracture may not be there, but in most of the cases, you'll be getting multiple rib fractures corresponding to this heart injury. Compression of chest, grinding force, auto, heavy vehicle runover, will be getting in many instances. But the thing is, heavy blunt force on chest. And this is another specimen we have. This is the first one is the medial view, and medial view from the medial aspect of one hemisphere of brain, and the second thing is actually the view from the lateral aspect. And here we you can see the dura is intact. So outside the dura, you can see some black color things. That is our extradural or epidural hemorrhage. Because dura, arachnoid and pia mater, and outside the dura, we will call it as extradural hemorrhage. And inside the dura, but outside arachnoid, we will be calling it a subdural hemorrhage. And if it is completely inside arachnoid matter, we call it as subarachnoid hemorrhage. So this is an extradural hemorrhage specimen we have in our own mortuary, means our own museum. So below skull and above dura. Source of bleeding is, the commonest source is middle meningeal artery tear due to skull fracture. And EDH is always traumatic. Natural causes are not the common. Very, very rare instance, it may be possible, but commonly natural causes are not there for EDH. It's always traumatic. And because there is chance of slow developing of EDH, so you have to observe people for 2 days. And this is subdural hematoma, because in right side you can see the dura is removed, and outside, and there is clots. And it's not a wet specimen, it's a photograph, and you can get same similar cases in our mortuary also, in our museum also. So this can be kept, and under dura mater and above arachnoid mater, remove well of cranial wall, dura mater flap remove side. Okay, I have already explained. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, and doesn't get, and in this matrica swelling is wrong. And subarachnoid hemorrhage, it doesn't get washed, means subdural and subarachnoid hemorrhage will be looking same. So if you wash the brain properly, the subdural will go, but arachnoid is very well attached to the brain surface, so then that will last there. So that is the easiest differentiation of SH and SDH during postmortem. That is the way we can use it. But if you see many cases, it won't be needed. And under arachnoid matter and above outside pia matter, that will be along with the brain surface. You cannot wash it off. And there is possibility of natural subarachnoid hemorrhage. The rupture of bridging veins are producing or even conduction can also produce extravasation of blood in the nearby tissues, and that will be collected beneath the arachnoid matter. That can also produce subarachnoid hemorrhage. And natural subarachnoid hemorrhage commonly caused by rupture of Berry aneurysm at the circle of Willis. Presentation will be different. That will be the SAH will be more thick at base of brain in case of natural SAH or spontaneous SAH. You can see some intraparenchymal on the left upper quadrant. I can say 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock portion, you can say some black color. They are intraparenchymal bleed, and conductions also can be seen like this. Differences we have already discussed. So these possible questions are not exactly for our best specimen. What is lucid interval? That can be asked in your theory also it can be asked. And what is this medico-legal importance? Means that you can read better. Head injury or in psychiatry, forensic psychiatry, you can get a detailed description of lucid interval. Person may be well aware, even though there is head injury, or even though there is psychiatric illness, there will be a gap of consciousness, proper consciousness, and medico-legal importance of that lucid interval, you can read more. At that time, he can give consent, he can go, or he'll be considered as a normal individual. And incised and stab wounds ka difference, I think we have already discussed length and breadth wala thing. And other things are not belongs to this portion. This questions belongs to weapon wala portion. I think you will get a class on that, or you have already got a class on that. And so the other questions are not about exactly about today's topic. So main point is in toxicology specimen, all are given in your textbook. And before your exam, you can come and see it once. And we will be keeping very limited, because we have many specimens in our museum, but then also I showed you very less because it's very difficult to memorize to an extent. But you have to know what is the pathology, and it will be very useful for you people to learn other subjects in medicine. And this is a practical class, and this thing can be, every specimen I have shown you can be asked for your spotters, and questions based on this specimen can be asked in your viva also. So you can read more about these topics, and immediately before your exam, you can come and see the specimen once again at department. It will be useful. And the representative can take a screenshot of the attendance and send me.